Let's just do a little bit of Voice of Truth.
Yes, absolutely. Let's do
Voice of Truth.
All of Voice of Truth.
Here we go.
Oh, what I would do to have the kind of faith it takes to climb out of this boat I'm in. Onto the crashy waves, to step out of my comfort zone, into the realm of the unknown where Jesus lives. And he's holding out his hand.
To verse two, everybody, ready? Here we go. And
oh, what I would do to have the kind of strength it takes to stand before a giant. The swing and the throne, surrounded by the sound of the thousand warriors, shaking in their armor. Should it have the strength?
You guys okay if you say go? Vocals?
I ran over it like 14 times.
I can't even.
Now I just know it. I've aggressively memorized.
Cause I don't have anything in my mouth.
So, just gonna memorize it.
Okay. Are you good? Okay. Let's just start the first song, just to start. Thank you.
Lord be with you. Good morning and warm welcome to all. Special welcome to our guests and visitors joining us today, both here in person and online. It's good to have you here. My name is Glenn Schlecht. I'm the senior pastor here at Emmanuel. And as always, it's a joy to come together, to spend time with sisters and brothers in the faith, spend time with our Lord in His Word. And this morning, we are continuing our summer series. Oh, before I jump into that, I need to say to all the gentlemen, Happy Father's Day on this day as we celebrate dads and our fathers and the father figures of our lives. So thank you for that, and we will include that in our prayers today for sure. Now, in our summer series that we're continuing on, Living in Tension, going through couple of Old Testament books, looking at some of the major people and events going on in 1st, 2nd Samuel, 1st Kings. Today, we are hearing about the story of David and Goliath, the events surrounding that as David really kind of launches into becoming more and more visible and more a part of God and His work. So keep that in mind. We've got a long Old Testament reading. We're reading a good chunk of chapter 17 today, but to try to capture that full story of David and Goliath. So with that in mind, let's begin with a word of prayer. Would you join me, please? Father in heaven, as we gather here this morning for worship, we come with, again, grateful hearts, grateful for the opportunity we have to do this, to come again and hear of you and your word, your love for us, and all that you desire for us. And Lord, I pray that as we carry in to this time of worship, any number of things that may be on our hearts and minds, that you would speak to us. Speak to us through your word as you let your spirit move freely among us. So in that joy, in that anticipation, we place ourselves and our needs into your loving care, praying your blessing on us as we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. And I invite all who are able to please stand as we begin with our invocation and our opening psalm. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. From Psalm 9. The Lord is a refuge for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble. The nations have fallen into the pit they have dug. Their feet are caught in the net they have hidden.
The Lord is known by his acts of justice. The wicked are ensnared by the work of their hands.
The wicked go down to the realm of the dead, all the nations that forget God.
But God will never forget the needy. The hope of the afflicted will never perish.
Arise, Lord. Do not let mortals triumph. Let the nations be judged in your presence.
Was his refuge and his strength, and he clung firmly to that truth when he fought the giant Goliath. God is our strength.
God is our refuge. God is our strength.
We will not fear though the mountains be moved.
We will not fear though the mountains be moved.
Nations will rage and the kingdoms will fall.
Nations will rage and the kingdoms will fall.
God is always with us. He is our fortress.
God is always with us. He is our fortress.
Gathering together as one. Together we sing.
acts of the Lord.
Come and behold all the works of the Lord.
He breaks the bow and he shatters the spear.
Breaks the bow and he shatters the spear.
Gathering together as one, praising Father, Spirit, and Son. Together we sing. You are real.
Our very real, very present God, as we'll hear from David, as Brianna had mentioned, that trust in the Lord, trust that He is our shield, our fortress, our strength, underlies our lives as followers of Jesus. And in that confidence, we put ourselves into His hands as we together confess our sins. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Too often, we allow fear to control us, and doubt can become the way of life for us. If we but look, we will see our lives and our world cradled in God's loving hands. Let us confess our lack of faith, even as we trust the One who has promised to listen to our words as well as our hearts. We join together to confess our sins before our Lord, first in the quiet of our hearts, and then together in the spoken confession. Almighty God, so often our fears, doubts, and worries threaten to wash over us. They can be such giants in our lives that we can come to believe that you do not care for us. There seems to be so much wrong in the world. We are convinced that there is nothing good we can do. The storms of sin and temptation batter at us, and we cower, unable to find the faith to withstand them. Forgive us, God of hope. Remind us that if we but open our hearts, you will heal us. If we but listen to your words, we will hear peace and joy. If we but open our lives to you, we can go forth to serve our sisters and brothers, even as we have been served by our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. With calming words, with a peaceful spirit, with overflowing love and hope, our God forgives us and fills us with faith. Our God affirms us for who we are, those whose brokenness is made whole, whose lives overflow with faith, and whose sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, go in that forgiveness, peace, and love. The Lord be with you. Let us pray together. O Lord, make us have perpetual love and reverence for your holy name. For you never fail to help and govern those whom you have set upon the sure foundation of your loving kindness. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated as we hear from God in His Word.
Our Old Testament reading for this morning comes from 1 Samuel chapter 17. Now, the Philistines gathered their forces for war and assembled at Socah in Judah. A champion named Goliath, who was from Gath, came out of the Philistine camp. His height was 6 cubits and a span. He had a bronze helmet on his head and wore a coat of scale armor of bronze weighing 5,000 shekels. On his legs, he wore bronze greaves, and a bronze javelin was slung on his back. His spear shaft was like a weaver's rod, and its iron point weighed 600 shekels. His shield bearer went ahead of him. Goliath stood and shouted to the ranks of Israel, "Why do you come out and line up for battle? Am I not a Philistine, and are you not the servants of Saul? Choose a man and have him come down to me. If he is able to fight and kill me, we will become your subjects. But if I overcome and kill him, you will become our subjects and serve us." Then the Philistine said, "This day I defy the armies of Israel. Give me a man and let us fight each other." On hearing the Philistine's words, Saul and the Israelites were dismayed and terrified. Early in the morning, David left the flock in the care of a shepherd, loaded up and set out, as Jesse had directed. He reached the camp as the army was going out to its battle positions, shouting the war cry. Israel and the Philistines were drawing up their lines and facing each other. David left his things with the keeper of supplies, ran to the battle lines, and asked his brothers how they were. As he was talking with them, Goliath, the Philistine champion from Gath, stepped out from his lines and shouted his usual defiance, and David heard it. When the Israelites saw the man, they all fled from him in great fear. David said to Saul, "Let no one lose heart on account of this Philistine. Your servant will go and fight him." Saul replied, "You are not able to go out and fight against this Philistine. You are only a young man, and he has been a warrior since his youth." But David said to Saul, "Your servant has been keeping his father's sheep. When a lion or a bear came and carried off a sheep from the flock, I went after it, struck it, and rescued the sheep from its mouth. When it turned on me, I seized it by the hair, struck it, and killed it. Your servant has killed both the lion and the bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, because he has defied the armies of the living God. The Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear will rescue me from the hand of this Philistine." Saul said to David, "Go, and the Lord be with you." Then Saul dressed David in his own tunic. He put a coat of armor on him and a bronze helmet on his head. David fastened on his sword over the tunic and tried walking around, because he was not used to them. "I cannot go out in these," he said to Saul, "because I'm not used to them." So he took them off. Then he took his staff in his hand and chose 5 smooth stones from the stream, put them in the pouch of his shepherd's bag, and with his sling in his hand, approached the Philistine. Meanwhile, the Philistine, with his shield bearer in front of him, kept coming closer to David. He looked David over and saw that he was little more than a boy, glowing with health and handsome, and he despised him. He said to David, "Am I a dog that you come out at me with sticks?" And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. "Come here," he said, "and I'll give your flesh to the birds and the wild animals." David said to the Philistine, "You come against me with a sword and a spear and a javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I'll strike you down and cut off your head. This very day I will give the carcasses of the Philistine army to the birds and the wild animals, and the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel.
All those gathered here will know that it is not by the sword or the spear that the Lord saves, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give all of you into our hands. As the Philistine moved closer to attack him, David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet him. Reaching into his bag and taking out a stone, he slung it and struck the Philistine on the forehead. The stone sunk into his forehead, and he fell face down on the ground. This is the word of the Lord. Our epistle reading for this morning comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 16 through 21. So, from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone, the new is here. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. This is the word of the Lord. Our gospel reading for this morning is from Mark chapter 4, verses 26 through 29. Jesus also said, "This is what the kingdom of God is like. A man scatters seed on the ground. Night and day, whether he sleeps or gets up, the seed sprouts and grows, though he does not know how. All by itself, the soil produces grain, first the stalk, then the head, and then the full kernel in the head. As soon as the grain is ripe, he puts the sickle to it because the harvest has come." This is the gospel of the Lord.
And could I have the children come on forward for this morning's children's message? Any parents or adults want to join, you're welcome to come up as well.
All right, good morning. Good morning. Awesome. So today we're going to answer the question, is bigger better? Because I think a lot of times we're told that the best things are the biggest, greatest, and the newest stuff. So I got all sorts of stuff with us today. I'm going to ask some questions, and hopefully we'll figure out if bigger is better. So can you hold that thread? Can you hold that string?
No.
Stand up. Hold it up so everyone can see it. Okay. So if we were trying to tie a bunch of wood sticks together, would you want to use the rope or the thread? What do we think? The rope, okay. But if we're trying to sew a button back onto our shirt, do we want the rope or the thread? The thread. So maybe bigger isn't better. Okay,
next example. Mia.
Soccer ball, Landon, tennis ball. Hold them up.
Okay.
If we're trying to knock over some bowling pins, would we want to use the tennis ball or the soccer ball? Soccer ball. But if we're trying to throw the ball as far as we can, would we want to use the soccer ball or the tennis ball? Tennis ball, okay? You can put those down. Sage, can you hold that for me? Whoops, sorry, Mia. And Bailey, will you hold that big blanket up? Okay, so say you're going to cuddle up and watch the best movie and you need a blanket. Is Miss Martha going to want this big quilt or the little baby blanket that Sage has? The big quilt. But if was going to cuddle up and watch a movie, do you think she would want the really big quilt or the really fluffy little blanket? The fluffy little blanket. Okay, now if I told you that we had to paint the whole sanctuary, would you want to use that paintbrush that Lane has or this one that I'm holding? The one that Lane has. But if you were painting some little thing for your family, like a little piece of paper or something, would you want to use the big brush or the little one? The little one. Okay. I think you guys are kind of getting it. So, if we had to go fight a battle, would we want the sword or the rock? Who votes sword? Who votes rock? If you voted rock, you've maybe heard of the story of David and Goliath. Because we heard today about how little shepherd boy David went to go fight the big giant Goliath. Now, Goliath had been fighting his whole life. He knew what he was doing. He could easily hurt you with that sword. But the thing that Goliath didn't have on his side was God. Good answer. So we know, though, that even though David was amazing, that the story is so awesome that we think about how cool David is, who's the absolute coolest in that story? God. Because we know that God takes not just the best things and the biggest things and the greatest things, but he uses all things, and that he can use anything. And the coolest thing is that he can use each of us to do amazing things. So it doesn't matter if everything's not the greatest and the biggest and the bestest. We have the greatest and the biggest and the bestest God who loves us so incredibly much. So let's thank him for always being with us by folding our hands and praying, and you can repeat after me. Dear God, thank you so much for always being with us. Thank you for giving us the biggest and bestest love. Amen. All right, thank you. You guys can throw all that stuff back in the bin, please.
Thank you, Miss Martha. So today really begins the journey that we're going to be walking along for a while with David. We heard last week that God had chosen him, selected him as the one who would be the king. He was anointed by the prophet Samuel, but it would be 15 years before he would actually sit on the throne. Living in tension, yeah. And there are a few things that went along with that. We also heard last week that the Lord had rejected Saul as the king. He told Samuel this. He said, "I, the Lord, am grieved that I've made Saul king, because he's turned away from me and has not carried out my instruction." And as soon as David was anointed to be king, we hear this, that the Spirit of the Lord came upon David in power. And conversely, in the very next verse, that the Spirit of the Lord had departed from Saul, and an evil spirit from the Lord tormented him. Then what comes is a rather ironic, awkward, and very tension-filled situation. Saul's attendants, his servants, recognized what was going on. Whether they heard exactly that he had this evil spirit, they sensed that there was something not right with Saul at various times. And so they came up with the idea of music soothes the savage beast, right? So we need to find someone to play music for Saul whenever he gets kind of out of sorts and out of his head, and that will calm him down. So they said, go find us someone who can play music for Saul. Who'd they find? David. Awkward, kind of ironic, but Saul brought in his successor, unbeknownst to him, into his very court. And it's even more interesting because we're told that Saul liked David very much, and David became one of his armor bearers, and he told David's father Jesse, allow David to remain in my service, for I am pleased with him. Is that crazy or what? And a real setup for some future tension, right? So immediately we move into today's events, with the Israelite army up against the Philistine army, and the Philistine army with their champion, the 9.5 foot tall giant, Goliath. You heard how the story played out. One of the pieces that was not included was the fact that for 40 straight days, in the morning, both armies would come out onto the battlefield. They would align in their battle formations. And then Goliath would step out of line and he would trash talk the Israelites and King Saul every single day for 40 days. This would happen. Now, what tensions can we recognize in this scenario? Well, for one, we've got this Israelite army. And what we know about the Israelite army is they were tough. This strong, battle-tested, many victories under their belt army was now being taunted by this one guy. And we're told every day, as soon as they saw Goliath, they all fled from him in great fear. And earlier, we're told that Saul and the whole army was dismayed and terrified. What gives? These warriors are terrified, scared to death of one guy. I don't know why, but it's a tension that was there day after day after day. And then the next tension comes when this kid David comes out of the field. His father Jesse had asked him. He was worried about his older sons who were in the battle out on the front lines. And so he called in his youngest. He called David in from tending the sheep. And he said, take this food to your brothers up on the front lines and find out for me how they're doing. So David went, he had grains and bread and cheese, and he took them up to the front lines, gave them to his brothers, and when he was at the front lines, he heard this Goliath and all of his taunting that was going on. And that really fired up David. And it fired him up because he heard what Goliath was actually saying. That apparently everybody else was somehow missing it. Either that or completely ignoring it. And the short of it is, what Goliath was doing, and David heard very clearly, was not only mocking and taunting and defying the Israelite army, David's brothers and his people, but Goliath was denying and taunting and putting down the living God himself, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And David would have none of it. So what did he do? He went right up to the king. Went up to King Saul, and he said, and this is my paraphrase, he said, King, I need you to tell everybody not to be afraid. Everything is going to be fine. I'm going to go out and fight this giant, you bunch of wimps. Well, that last part probably wasn't there. I kind of added that in. And I'm kind of thinking that's what David might have felt there. But, so he said that, and Saul's initial reaction was, you're nuts, kid. You are just a boy. And this Goliath is a fighting machine who has been in battle since he was a youth. Well, David came back to him with a very compelling argument. And after that compelling argument, Saul's heart, his mind was changed, and he said, okay, go, and the Lord be with you. Now, what was that compelling argument that changed Saul's mind about this? Again, the short of it is, David said, I've been practicing for this moment my entire life. I'm out in the fields, day after day, watching my sheep, and I am fending off, fighting, and killing lions and bears. And this Philistine, he's no different. It's going to be the same. And the thing is that David recognized that, you know, this wasn't just a, hey, I'm an awesome fighter and warrior. But there was something else, something very important that David recognized from his youth and would carry him throughout all of his years. Listen to this. This is what he told him. David said to King Saul, "The Lord, who rescued me from the paw of the lion, the paw of the bear, will rescue me from the hand of the Philistine." So if it wasn't just David's great fighting skills, what was it? Or who was it? It was the Lord, right? The Lord. And did you catch the wording? So important here. The word that David chose to use in describing what was happening here. Do you remember what that was? Did you hear it? Rescued. The Lord rescued me from the paw or the claws and jaws of the lion and the bear, and he will rescue me from the hand of this Philistine. David is speaking in a very passive sense. Now, he's planning on going out. I mean, he's a warrior already as a young kid. He is a fighter. But he is putting himself in the hands of his Lord and his God, saying, God has rescued me in all those times and all those fighting, all the fighting that I had to try to protect my sheep. And he's going to rescue me here as well. So, that compelling argument set the foundation for what we would hear from David as he wrote many of the Psalms, and the Psalms of the Old Testament songbook, some of which we sang today that really echoed our theme for today, or what's going on here in this idea of the Lord rescuing. But listen to just these couple of Psalms, a very, very small sampling, and listen to the wording that David was inspired to write in these songs, in these poems. Psalm 28, "The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him and he helps me." Psalm 46 that we sang this morning, "God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble." And then Psalm 59, "The Lord is my strength, my fortress, my refuge in times of trouble." For David, you see, this was no beating his chest and saying, "Ugh, look at me, how tough and strong I am." But this was really David going, "The Lord is my strength. The Lord is my champion. The Lord is the real warrior in all of this. And the Lord is the king." Now, with all of these psalms and so many of David's actions, these all reflect his faith, and actually they reflect our faith as well. David was what we can refer to or call a type of Christ. And that means that David, in some of his actions, some of his life, he was a reflection of the promised Messiah. He was a reflection of Jesus and some of what Jesus would come to be and do. And so what David is inspired to do and inspired to write gives us that sense that the people were looking at the coming Messiah already in David. And what we have here for us as we look back in what David was reflecting was Jesus and what Jesus had done and what we know he accomplished as he, if you will, battled the ultimate Goliath of the devil, of our sin, and even of death. And in that battle against the ultimate Goliath, Jesus came out victorious by way of a blood-stained cross and an empty tomb. And because of that, you and I can sing David's Psalms as our own, that we trust in the Lord, that we know him to be our help, our shield, our strength, our refuge, our fortress, our Savior. Now, there's more going on here that reflects David's attitude and David's heart and his trust in the Lord. As soon as Saul was convinced that, okay, David's going to do it, what Saul did made perfect sense. He armored David up. He put on David all of his armor, gave him not only the best of armor and helmet and shield, but the best weapons he had. And as soon as David had those on, and you can almost picture this, him kind of clunking around, he said, "I can't do this. I don't fight like this." And he took it all off. He got rid of all of it. And this is a small reflection, another reflection of how our Lord chooses to work. What he does, how he goes about everything, that it seems to our human way of looking and thinking of it, completely backward, totally illogical. And how do we see that play out? Well, we see it here, first in the selection of David as the next king that we heard last week. Not the biggest, not the best, not the firstborn son, but a little kid out in the field. And God says, yeah, that's the one that's going to be the king. Here, with David saying, I don't need this armor. I can't do all this. Jump ahead to Jesus, real quick, thinking about all the different ways around surrounding Jesus and his life that, as we think about it, just make no sense whatsoever. God's choosing of his parents, Mary and Joseph. They were in the right line, the right lineage, the right family, but Mary was this young girl, ordinary, unknown. Joseph, blue-collar guy, carpenter, worked with his hands, again, unknown. Jesus was born where? Give me a town. Thank you. Okay, you're with me, awake, just checking in. Born in that little town of Bethlehem, not in the capital of Jerusalem, that he was born on the rinky-dink town outskirts. Born not surrounded by royalty, but surrounded by farm animals. Jesus, from our vantage point, selected his followers. I'd say the most unlikely and most unqualified people he could find, those are the ones he picked. Then he hung around with tax collectors, with prostitutes, and with the low-life sinners that were all around him. Jesus honored and upheld women and children, which was unheard of back in the first century. The last week in Jesus' life, he rode in Jerusalem on a donkey, not on this war horse. And he went into battle, not calling down his tens of thousands of angels, but by laying down his life, giving it up for our salvation, for our life. Over and over again, we hear, like the Lord said through the prophet Isaiah, chapter 55, he said, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways." So, back to the story. David took his sling and four more stones than he needed, and he went out to confront Goliath. And with one swing of the sling, down he went. And the victory was his. And it comes back for David and for us to trust in the Lord, even when some things seem totally backward, totally nonsensical. reminds us, I'm still Lord. I'm still King. And I'm still with you. Now, with that in mind, I want to give you a moment to think about some of the giants in your life. What are some of those things in your life that threaten you, that may be overwhelming you, that may be scaring you, but may feel like giants to you right now? So take a moment to think about this. If you're comfortable talking with each other about it, please do. But take a moment. The giants in your life right now. All right, let me hear. Any of you willing to share, just in a very short phrase or a couple of words, what are some of those giants in your life right now? Kyle? All right, the Habitat House that you guys are a part of, looking forward to stepping into. It's a little overwhelming, can it be? Other giants, Gail? Okay, cultural changes in our country, and there seem to be a few right now. What else? Cindy? Say that one more time. Planning PJ's future. Giant. A giant. Yeah. Others? Giants for you right now? Yes, sir. Going to a new school. Giant. A giant, scary, overwhelming. Rachel? Work expectations can be giants for us. Amy? High cost of living. There's a lot out there, isn't there? Could add in, kind of in a general sense, fears, doubts, economic stuff, finances, job-related things. Lots can be these giants for us. And I have to be honest, I wish I could say that, you know what, it's just a matter of me preaching to you, saying, trust in the Lord, and all those giants will be slain. All of them. You just need to have more faith. You just need to have a stronger faith. And then all these obstacles will be destroyed. Don't get me wrong. There's a piece of that that there is some truth in. That call of our Lord and what we saw in David and in others in God's Word of the trust that they had in the Lord, the trust that we are invited to have, a trust to move mountains, a trust beyond anything we could imagine. So I want you to watch a clip. I'm going to wrap up this morning and kind of pull some things together with a clip from this movie, Facing the Giants, an inspirational kind of David and Goliath football movie. It's about a Christian high school, the Shiloh Eagles, a small high school, who against insurmountable odds made it to the state championship. And at that state championship, the clip right before the clip we're going to watch, which is in the locker room, they are at the state championship, time is winding down, they are losing, and there's only seconds to go. And what happens is they bring in a second string place kicker, a skinny little kid by the name of David, and say, you're going to kick a 51-yard field goal for the win. And it goes back and forth, and he said, I've never kicked a ball more than 39 yards in my life. Short of it is, he steps in, he kicks a 51-yard field goal, time expires, and they are the state champions, defeating the three-time defending champions, the Richmond Giants. And what I want you to listen for is what Coach Taylor has to say in the locker room. It's not, you can do anything with God in your life. Okay? Be clear on that. Listen closely. It's not, you can do anything with God in your life. There's something far more subtle here and far more important. Let's watch and listen.
I got something to say. David Childers. Don't you ever let anyone tell you that you're under par, second rate, or inferior. I just watched God do a miracle through you. I saw a field of giants, 85 of them to be exact, fall in defeat. Now you tell me what's impossible with God.
Nothing, Coach.
Zach, I just watched you and the offense do what they said could not be done. Now you tell me what's impossible with God.
Nothing, Coach.
Brah, how about it? Built that stone wall, didn't you? And it stood. Now you tell me what's impossible with God.
Nothing, Coach.
How about it, Scott? What's impossible with God?
Nothing.
Are you sure? Because those giants are big. They have numbers 3-1. Are you sure there's nothing impossible with God?
I'm sure, Coach.
How about it, Nathan? What's impossible with God?
Nothing, Coach.
Jonathan?
Nothing.
Are you positive?
Positive, Coach.
So am I. So am I. God can do whatever he wants to do, however he wants to do it. And he chooses to work in our lives because he loves us, because he's good. Hope today is a milestone for what he can do for the rest of your life if you trust him. And we spend some time thanking him.
What Coach Taylor said, God can do whatever he wants to do, however he wants to do it. And he chooses to work in our lives because he loves us, because he's good. I hope today is a milestone for what he can do for the rest of your life if you trust him. Not every giant is going to be slain. Not every 51-yard field goal attempt is going to go through the uprights. Not every obstacle is going to be overcome. But rest assured that as we trust in our Lord with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, with all our strength, we know that the ultimate victory is ours. And he's going to work in our lives, how he chooses and when he chooses. There are times that we experience those victories and those miracles, and other times that we're down here wondering which way to turn. But in all these circumstances, we know that our King has slain the giants. Our King is victorious, and he will continue to walk with us. He will continue to see us through, no matter what it is that we may be facing, that we are not alone. The what now for today? It's up on the screen. also the insert in your announcements. I'm encouraging you this week to do this. Face the giants in your life, not with fear, but with faith. Trust in the Lord Jesus and entrust the outcomes to Him, be they good or bad from our perspective, putting yourself in His strong and loving arms. And remember, friends, He chooses now to work in our lives, having slain the giants, because He loves us and because He's good. Amen. And that peace of God, a peace that at times goes beyond our understanding, let it guard our hearts and our minds through faith in Christ Jesus, today and always. Amen. I invite all who are able to please stand. Let's join in confessing our faith this morning using the words of the Nicene Creed, one of those ancient statements of faith with God's word, His truth, laid out for us simply and beautifully. We join our voices with those who have gone before us and with those who stand with us here and around the world. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of His Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day He rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And He will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated, and we continue with our time of offering. And whether you brought an offering today that you are leaving or have left in the offering baskets, or offerings that you leave online, it's the opportunity we take each week to pause and remember that this is not about funding the church, but it's about giving thanks to God for the blessings He has poured into our lives. And we respond. We say, thank You, Lord, through the gifts we give, that His work in us, among us, and through us would continue. So with that in mind, join me in reiterating again this morning some of these beautiful promises God gives to us. Friends in Christ, we know that all we have, all we do, or all we are and all we do are gifts from God. God does not need our offerings, but He knows that life is better when we share generously from all that we have of our time, talents, and treasures. As we give our offerings, a tenth or so, we're giving thanks to God for His abundant gifts to us. Heavenly Father, give us Your grace to share generously, and in doing so, be refreshed in You. Amen. And for our prayers today, we have continuing prayers for healing for Elizabeth Grimm's dad, who's now home, for Tom Gonzalez, for Jeff and Bobby, good friends of Jamie Sweet, for Kathy's and my daughter-in-law, Leah's sister, Chloe, for Mary Chase's brother, Chris, and Austin, for Ashley Mush, and for Betsy Hamp's dad. We also pray for Jane Ernst, who broke her leg while she's in Florida, for Shirley Gonzalez, who is dealing with some serious health-related issues, being diagnosed with gastrointestinal stromal tumor with some liver metastases. So we pray for wisdom for the doctors as they try to figure out the best approach to this, and for healing for Shirley. We also pray for Leslie Husingfeld and Colette Reel and their families as they celebrated their mother, Lorraine Jorgensen, yesterday with her memorial service. For John and Annette Lewis, Annette was hospitalized on Thursday morning and has been diagnosed with a couple of blood clots in her lungs. Prayers for those to be dissolved safely. And for John, John was just diagnosed with prostate cancer, so prayers for strength, strength for him as he begins those steps toward treatment. For longtime former members, Tim Sweeney and Mike Hunziker, who both have been battling very serious bladder issues. For Lonnie and Kathy Leiniger's son, Tim, who had successful eye surgery on Tuesday, prayers for healing and that the hole in the back of his eye would heal up. For Jeannie Huebner, who recently fell in her backyard, seems to be okay, but will be seeing a doctor this week. For Irma Bartz, who was in the ER earlier this week with an infection and with heart concerns. And then for Cheryl Gilbert's mom, who had successful surgery, was able to return home very quickly. And for Lonnie and Kathy Leiniger, as they celebrated on Wednesday their 53rd wedding anniversary. And then, we can clap for that. And then on this Father's Day, we also want to remember the fathers in our lives and father figures. So let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Father in heaven, you are loving and you are good, and we trust you in all matters. And so these many, many people and requests that we've expressed, as well as many others that have gone unspoken today, but are very much on our hearts and our minds that we've carried into this time of worship, we pray that you would speak to those needs, that you would provide the help that you know far better than we of what needs to happen. Give guidance and direction. Give peace and comfort. Be that refuge, that fortress, that strength that is needed for these days. And for the joys and celebrations, we know that those flow from your hand and your heart to us. And for all of them, we are very, very grateful. So, Lord, in all these matters, may your will be done and may your grace abound. Lord, in your mercy, for our ministry together, especially with all of the upcoming ministries and activities and events tied into our children's ministry, but so much more as well. I pray that you would help us keep Jesus at the very center of every event, every activity, that all we are and do will point back to Jesus time and time again. Lord, in your mercy, on this Father's Day, we give you thanks for our fathers and the father figures in our lives. We thank you for opportunities to be fathers and to be father figures for children and youth and others that God brings into our lives. Lord, we also pray today for those who have been hurt by fathers, those who've experienced abuse of various sorts, or estrangement, or hurt, or pain. And in all these matters, I pray that you would help us to see and recognize you as our Father, a good Father, a loving Father, who demonstrates everything that is right. So, Lord, help us all look to you and come to you as the Father that you desire to be. Lord, in your mercy. And for President Biden, for our world leaders, for all those elected and appointed throughout every level of our government, guide and direct them, help them to govern wisely and well based on your truth, your word. And Lord, we also lift up those who are on the front lines, all who will serve in healthcare professions, law enforcement, first responders, firefighters, and the men and women of our armed forces. Lord, for all of these people who are willing to put themselves in harm's way for our health, our safety, for our protection, and for the freedoms we enjoy, we ask your blessing on them Watch over them. Keep them safe and in your care. Lord, in your mercy, into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who has also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And as many of you know, we celebrate the Lord's Supper here at Emmanuel each week. And we do that not because we have to, but because we get to. That we know that the Lord works through this amazing gift to bring us what we need the most. Assurance, forgiveness, strength, and the ability to be the people of God that he has called us to be, standing up against the giants in our lives. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also after supper, he took the cup. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant that is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Now, if there are any of you here today wondering whether or not you should come and receive the Lord's Supper, would you ask yourself these four questions? First, do you know Jesus? Do you believe in him, know him as your Lord, your Savior? Secondly, do you acknowledge the sin and brokenness in your own life and desire the forgiveness and the healing that the Lord offers in this sacrament? Third, do you believe our Lord's words, profound, mysterious words, but do you believe it to be true, that what we receive today goes far beyond just bread and wine, and it is the very body and blood of Jesus? And finally, fourth, would it be your intention, with the Holy Spirit at work in your heart, that you would seek to live a life of sharing Jesus and his love with the people that God brings to you? If you answer yes to these questions, this gift is for you. We have our two serving stations on either side of the communion rail. Children and young people not yet instructed in the Lord's Supper, you're invited to come for a blessing. Or if they're adults who would prefer simply to receive a blessing, please come with your hands folded to indicate that. Otherwise, have your hands cupped to receive the bread. My friends, the table is ready, and the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Yeah. Your way.
Sisters and brothers in Christ, these gifts that we have received, I pray that they will accomplish in each of us exactly what the Lord desires. Assurance that our sin is forgiven, confident that His love is unending, and knowing that as we walk out these doors, we go not alone, but our Lord is with us. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you His peace. And I pray that that truly is the case for all of us as we continue to listen to His voice, His truth for our lives. By way of announcements, just briefly, again, there are a lot of things that are happening coming up over the next month and a half with our children's ministry in particular. And Martha, Miss Martha, redid her entire table back there. So stop in, take a look. Different ways, opportunities to help and support and engage in ministry with our youngest ones. Reminder that outdoor worship for this service begins in 2 weeks. July 4th, we will be out under the pergola on the west lawn. Bring lawn chairs, invite friends, bring your Bibles, but that'll be happening 2 weeks from now. And then, I mentioned this last week, but once again, Kristen Volstead of our congregation is going to be attending the Lutheran Women in Mission, the LWML convention in Lexington, Kentucky, leaving this week, right? Later this week. And Kristen is taking pledges for a walk she's going to be participating in. All the funds for that are going to be going toward mission projects of the LWML. So if you'd like to support Kristen and some of those mission projects, she's going to be hanging around the atrium by the tables back there. Catch her. I'll have something, an email update this week as well. Email updates go out several times a week. If you're not on that email list, that's the place to get the most up-to-date information on what's happening, what's coming, how to engage and be involved. Stop at the coffee cart, the information station. We've got cards there. You can fill those out, put the card in one of our offering baskets, or for those online, just reach out by email. We'll get you added to it. Next Sunday, we continue our summer series, Living in Tension, and we're going to be dealing with a heavy topic. We're going to be dealing with the tension of death. So, it's heavy, but some important things that we're going to glean from David as he experienced the death of Saul and the death of his good friend Jonathan and where that leads us in this life and in these times. So I hope you can join me next week. For now, go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Of days, pavilioned in splendor and girl.